Bun găsit la emisiunea Știință și Cunoaștere! În luna decembrie 2015 căutam pe internet informații legate de modul în care trecerea timpului influențează procesele biologice și fiziologice. Am găsit titluri ale unor postări pe diverse site-uri care pur și simplu sfidează rațiunea. Iată câteva exemple. Mecanismul de revers în timp biologic, reîntinerirea celulară și câmpurile electromagnetice. Reversul îmbătrânirii cu David Sinclair. Este posibilă inversarea îmbătrânirii, cu același David Sinclair, profesor de genetică la Universitatea Harvard. Michio Kaku încearcă să ne explice cum se poate face practic reversul îmbătrânirii și aveți toate linkurile acestor surse de informare unde materialele sunt disponibile online. E șocant să descoper nu doar unul, ci chiar foarte mulți cercetători de prestigiu, cu lucrări serioase publicate în reviste de top, care afirmă că putem reversa timpul biologic. Iată un alt exemplu. Conferința purtând titlul Oameni de știință foarte aproape de reversul îmbătrânirii, având durata de aproape 2 ore. Mai avem și o pagină de Facebook a comunității Aging Reversed, care gestionează o mulțime de materiale noi foarte interesante, dar cred că cel mai impresionant titlu de conferință îi aparține lui Michael Fossel, și anume Resetând ADN-ul, oprirea îmbătrânirii. Deja în acest moment al căutărilor mele am înțeles că se întâmplă un lucru extraordinar pe plan mondial din punct de vedere al evoluției științelor vieții. La fel de surprinzător a fost faptul că toți acești oameni de știință lucrează de peste 30-35 de ani în acest domeniu, dar în momentul de față au ajuns la câteva rezultate, au obținut suficiente date relevante și teoriile lor sunt deja verificabile pe modele de laborator. Este oare posibil să reversăm timpul biologic și să redevenim tineri cu 10, 20 sau chiar 30 de ani? Este oare posibil să ne extindem durata vieții până la vârsta de 150 sau chiar 200 de ani și totodată să trăim tineri și mereu sănătoși? Acesta pare a fi un subiect scos din filmele science fiction, precum Vârsta lui Adeline sau Cazul neobișnuit al lui Benjamin Button. Cu toate acestea, un număr tot mai mare de oameni de știință au realizat studii independente în laboratoare specializate de peste 30 de ani și în momentul de față au ajuns la rezultate remarcabile. Ei pot răspunde afirmativ la întrebările pe care tocmai le-am precizat mai devreme. După mai multe încercări nereușite de a realiza interviuri cu acești oameni de știință, unul dintre ei a acceptat provocarea și peste câteva momente veți avea ocazia să vedeți cel mai tulburător interviu din câte am făcut până acum la Știință și Cunoaștere. Datorită faptului că acum știința răspunde afirmativ la posibilitatea reversului în timp biologic, am avut îndrăzneala să-mi prezint succint și propriile observații ale unui fenomen fiziologic personal ce pare să evidențieze mici modificări legate de viteza de îmbătrânire, fapt care a trezit o anumită curiozitate și din partea invitatului emisiunii. Michael B. Fossel, având în prezent vârsta de 66 de ani, este profesor de medicină clinică la Universitatea de Stat Michigan și este autorul mai multor cărți despre îmbătrânire. Michael este cel mai bine cunoscut pentru opiniile sale privind terapia telomerazei ca un posibil tratament pentru senescența celulară, adică îmbătrânirea celulară. A urmat masteratul la Stanford Medical School, după care a câștigat un titlu de doctor BA cum laude și a făcut încă un masterat în psihologie la Universitatea Wesleyan, urmat apoi de un doctorat în neurobiologie la Universitatea Stanford. El este absolvent al Academiei Phillips Exeter. Înainte de a absolvi școala medicală în 1981, a primit o bursă de studii la National Science Foundation, Fundația Națională de Știință, și apoi a predat la Universitatea Stanford. Pe lângă postul de profesor universitar ocupat la Universitatea de Stat Michigan, Michael Fossel a ținut conferințe la Institutul Național pentru Sănătate, Institutul Smithsonian și la diverse alte universități și institute din mai multe părți ale lumii. Michael Fossel a fost membru activ în conducerea Consiliului de Administrație al Asociației Aging American, ocupând funcția de director executiv. El a fost fondatorul și fost redactor șef al revistei de medicină Anti-Aging, cunoscută acum sub numele de Cercetare a Întineririi. În cartea sa, Revoluția Telomerazei, autorul Michael Fossel afirmă următoarele, citez: suntem la un pas de a face un salt imens înainte și vom deveni capabili să reversăm procesul de îmbătrânire într-un mod evident și izbitor. Suntem pe cale de a vindeca și nu doar de a preveni maladiile legate de îmbătrânire, dar mai mult putem reseta procesul de îmbătrânire ca atare. Am încheiat citatul. În minutele următoare vom vorbi despre teoriile îmbătrânirii, vom face un scurt istoric, inclusiv prezentarea miturilor și înțelegerilor eronate și vom dezbate apoi pe larg teoria telomerică a îmbătrânirii, singura care a primit cele mai multe acreditări, după care vom încerca să elucidăm enigma bolilor degenerative. Fiți alături de noi în acest miniserial special la Știință și Cunoaștere. Dear Professor Michael Fossel, welcome to our Science and Knowledge TV program for the first time in Romania on TVR Cluj.
Mulțumesc!
Mulțumesc și eu de asemenea.
Cu plăcere!
I already made a short introduction for the Romanian viewers regarding your most important scientific activity, which had been written as notes for a YouTube video entitled Resetting DNA, Stop Aging. And that's how I met you. And this was the main reason for getting in touch with you. First question, please tell us very shortly what happened in the past few years when scientists have made extraordinary progress in understanding human aging, and when did you get involved in the field of aging?
I first got involved almost 30 years ago. But 20 years ago, I was going to write a textbook on aging, and I ran into some of the early research on gene expression in regard to telomeres. And for me, it sort of finally put together all of the disparate parts of aging. And then there was some fascinating research. In the past now 16 years, we have shown that you can actually reverse aging in human cells, and then in human tissues, and then, at least to some degree, in actual animals. So we'd like to move ahead with human studies aimed at curing diseases like Alzheimer's.
Your latest book, entitled The Telomerase Revolution, is on the basis for our discussion today, and I hope to make more episodes. I began to read it with great interest, and its content follows exactly a structure for creating a very fascinating TV interview. So we can prolong our interview on two episodes, both of them 55 minutes. This is the most amazing book I ever read. And you wrote it exactly on the fashion known as public understanding of science. Because I'm not a scientist, but I could easily understand your book. Next question. Please describe for our viewers the previous myths and theories of aging. First, the anthropic theory of aging. Page 20 from your book.
Well, one of the problems people have had with aging is they've always just assumed it just happened. It's just a matter of entropy. Things fall apart. But that usually comes because we only look at a few species. We look at ourselves, dogs, cats, birds, cattle. We look at animals we're aware of which show aging. But one, we know there are some animals that don't actually show aging. And two, if you look back in the past and ask where we came from, we had cells from your mother who got it from her mother and her mother all the way back. The line of cells goes back in an unbroken fashion for about 3.5 billion years. And that shows us that aging doesn't always happen in cells. It happens in some cases, but not in other cases. So we know that aging is not simply entropy. One of the things that life does is resist entropy. It maintains organization and complexity in the face of entropy. So the question is not, does aging cause entropy? Because it doesn't. But why does entropy allow aging to occur in some cases, and yet in other cases, it doesn't happen? That's part of the myth. The myth is just, it's just entropy. No, it's more complex than that. There's something more sophisticated going on.
Next, as science developed, another theory appeared and was known as the vitalist theory of aging.
Well, of course, people who are involved in what I call the vitalist theory of aging would never call it that. Because when I say vitalism, it sort of harkens back a century or two, and now we make fun of that idea. And yet, the concepts remain. So, for example, you'll find people who feel that aging is solely a matter of something that wears out, whether it's heartbeats or genes or whether it's hormones. And the assumption has been that you've got a certain amount of something at birth, and then it goes away and you die. But it's, again, there are problems with that. For example, if we're looking at hormonal theories of aging, and if we think that aging is simply a matter of a particular hormone that runs out, it begs the question of, well, then what makes that hormone run out? which is just another form of aging. So you've just stepped back a little bit. You're still begging the question of, if hormone losses cause aging, what causes hormone loss? So all of these things basically are like a vitalist theory of aging. We also see this in looking at the difference between cells and tissues. There are some people back now about 70, 80 years ago who honestly believed that aging did not occur within cells. It was something that occurred between cells. It was some magic process between cells. And yet we know that cells themselves age. So it's not simply something magical that occurs only between cells or in hormones or only a certain number of heartbeats or a certain number of cross-linked proteins or damaged DNA. Again, there's something a little more mysterious going on behind that. I sometimes think of downstream, upstream. A lot of people are looking at downstream effects. They're not thinking back upstream of what caused those effects. So they tend to have these mysterious ideas that amount to vitalism. But no, there's something, again, a little bit more mysterious going on, a little more complex going on.
Next, I'll skip now to more recent theory, the mitochondrial or free radical theory of aging, page 25, because we still hear a lot of about free radical, and then this created an enormous amount on the topic of extending life through diet. But please tell us, what are the wrong beliefs? And let's separate the myths from real facts.
Well, it's interesting because part of the problem is we get very sloppy when we talk about causes of aging. Some people have said that I think telomeres cause aging. No, I don't. Other people will think that mitochondria cause aging. Well, they're right and wrong. It's clear that free radical damage and mitochondria play a big role in aging, but so do other things. So do cross-linked proteins. So do a number of changes within the body and at the cellular level within cells. But none of those things are the cause. It's, again, more complex than that. There's an entire cascade of things going on. So if we're looking at mitochondria, and you might think mitochondria aging causes aging, it's not a bad thought. The problem is that, again, your mitochondria, all you inherited from your mother, back from her mother, they were inherited in the female line. And we can track that back about 1.5 billion years. So what that tells us is that mitochondria didn't age for 1.5 billion years when you inherited them as a young fertilized egg. And yet somehow in a matter of decades, your mitochondria age. So again, if you're going to say that mitochondria cause aging, what you really have to say is mitochondria age sometimes, but not other times. So again, it begs the question, what causes mitochondria to age sometimes and not other times? Clearly, aging is not just a matter of mitochondria fail, you age, because it doesn't always happen. So again, mitochondria are sort of a downstream thing. We need to go back upstream and say, what caused that to happen? Yes, this case, but not the other case. It's complex. It's more interesting than people think it is.
And obviously, in modern times, we also hear about genes and how we are controlled by genes. But in reality, we are not controlled by genes. Genes are less important than gene expression, which is epigenetics. Epi means above. And so epigenetics came into our attention. Thus, we do not have the so-called aging genes. So that was only a belief.
Well, let me use an analogy. If I go back about 100 years, people honestly believed that the difference between cells in this finger and cells in my nose were that they had different genes. Now, in general, throughout our body, with a few interesting exceptions, but in general, all the genes are the same. The difference is the pattern of expression. It's sort of like a symphony orchestra. The genes in my fingers are playing a tune that says finger, and the genes in my nose are playing a tune that says nose. But that's the same orchestra, same set of genes, they're playing a different tune. But the same thing is going on in aging. The difference between me at age 6 and me now at age 65 is that it's not that I have different genes, and it's not that the genes are damaged. It's that I'm playing a different tune on those same genes. So that brings an interesting question up, which is, can I reset the tune and go from an aging and perhaps sick body to a healthier body and prevent disease? When we're talking about aging genes, the same thing happens. There's this misconception that genes are everything. Well, they are critical, but still, gene expression is an enormously important thing. Again, the difference between your fingers and your nose is not genetic, it's epigenetic. The difference between young and old is not genetic, it's epigenetic. So genes play a role, but if we're looking at aging diseases, and I think we'll come back to this in this conversation later, you know, the difference between people with Alzheimer's and people who don't have Alzheimer's, it's not just genes, It's a matter of gene expression. And genes play some role. They're not unimportant. But as it turns out, whether we're looking at cholesterol deposition and heart disease or Alzheimer's, it's not simply a matter of genes, nor is it a matter of just genes and aging. There are genes that play a role, but there aren't aging genes and there aren't Alzheimer's genes. There are genes that increase and decrease your risk and that change their expression. So once again, things are more complex than just genes. It's something a little different.
But let me try to reformulate and correct me if I'm wrong. If I have a gene which may cause Alzheimer's, but it does not express, then this is not 100% that I'll get the disease.
That's correct. So all of us have genes that have risks, but they're only risks in certain circumstances. And these can be behavioral circumstances, for example, if I smoke or don't smoke. They could be dietary circumstances, for example, do I eat more vegetables or fewer vegetables? So the genes change. Or stress, a good example, or aging. One of the analogies I use often is that of a lake. If I'm sailing across a lake, I can sail across that lake fine if the water level's high. Now, underneath that, there may be a number of hidden rocks. Those are genes that have risks for you. For example, risk of heart attack or risk of Alzheimer's disease. But if the water level's high enough, it's not a problem. But as we age, we change the pattern of gene expression. The lake level falls, and sooner or later, I expose the rock. That's sort of what's going on with, for example, APOE4 genes and Alzheimer's or other genes to do with cholesterol metabolism and heart disease. It's not that they cause it, but that you expose the risk as you age the entire organism.
Yes, but the myth is still present on media. For more than 20 years, we hear those myths. And also when someone goes to a physician and the physician said, oh, you have a bad gene.
Well, sometimes you do. Example, say you have sickle cell anemia. That clearly is genetic, and the epigenetics play almost no role in that. It's you've got the gene or you don't have the gene. And there are diseases like that. But most diseases, particularly age-related diseases, are not strictly genetic. They have to do with whether the pattern of expression changes and exposes that underlying risk, exposes the rock as the water level falls. And there's so much focus in medicine these days, and for that matter in research, on identifying the genes. And people don't realize how much that changes with the epigenetics, the expression pattern. My approach would be, let's not go out and blow up the rocks and try to fix the gene. What if we raise the level of the water so that the risk goes down again? 20-year-olds don't have Alzheimer's even if they have APOE4. It's not just a matter of the passage of time, it's the change of gene expression that exposes that risk. So clinically, I think it's going to be a lot more effective if we can alter the pattern of gene expression rather than simply go after individual genes. But most people, we think simplistically. We think it's a gene. Not quite. It's more than just the gene. It's the expression of the gene. It's the life you lead. It's the behaviors you have.
Please tell us the real telomere theory of aging, which now seems to be widely spread. And many researchers are indicating in their conclusions the same data, the same results.
Well, let me say first that we probably shouldn't call it the telomere theory of aging. We do. But we could call it the gene expression theory of aging, or we could call it epigenetic theory of aging. We could call it a number of things. Telomeres are only one part of it. It is not true that telomeres cause aging. That's a misconception. And yet, they play a critical role in it. Overall, what's sort of happening is this. Let's look at a simple system. For example, the cells in your knee. The cells in your knee are chondrocytes, and they line the knee, and they provide a really smooth surface so that every time I move my knee, it slides easily. But every time I walk around, I lose a certain number of cells. And when that happens, the cells next to it divide to replace them. The telomeres shorten, which we can get into later. But then a critical step happens. It changes the pattern of gene expression. And that does several things. One is, it means the cells replace themselves more slowly. So as I get older, the replacement cells in my knee are dividing less quickly. And the surface gets a little thinner. But also the cells aren't doing their job. So not only are there fewer of them, but they're more importantly, they're not operating very well. For example, they're not making the substances I need within that knee to make it slippery. So what's happening is that as you age and cells divide, they change the pattern of gene expression, and they change the function of the tissue. So, for example, my knees no longer have as many cells, and now I've got bone on bone, and I begin to have to replace a knee joint. Now, there are other systems that are more complex, where there's one set of cells that's not dividing, and they're fine, but they're dependent on other cells that are dividing. And these cells no longer support the important cells. For example, in the brain, the neurons generally don't divide, but they're dependent on cells, for example, microglia and astrocytes, that divide. Or in your heart. You know, when you have heart disease, it's not the fault of the muscle, it's the fault of the vessels that supply the blood. And what we find is that the vessels themselves are aging, and the result is you have heart disease. The fact that the heart cells mostly don't divide, they do, but minimally, mostly don't divide, is not the problem. So in general, the telomere theory of aging says cells divide, they change their function, they become more and more dysfunctional, and you end up with disease. That's sort of it in a sentence.
A cell uses enzymes known as DNA polymerases to replicate the DNA that makes up the chromosome. Please describe the entire process, and what was the vision of Alexei Olovnikov, the scientist you met back in 1971?
Well, Alexei actually described the theory in 1971, but Alexei and I didn't get together until about 20 years later when I had him over to my home, here actually. And what Alexei said was something very interesting, and a lot of Westerners didn't pay attention to it because he said it in a Russian journal, and so they listened to Jim Watson, who wrote it in an English journal. But Alexei was still right, and he was ahead of Jim Watson by a year. And what Alexei said was this. He said, listen, if I have a chromosome and I'm going to copy it, what I need to do is I need to grab onto the chromosome with that DNA polymerase you mentioned, and then I start making copies of the rest of the chromosome. But he said the place the DNA polymerase grabs onto is where it holds on, so it can't replicate the part it's holding onto. It can only replicate just down from it. An analogy that's very useful is if I'm painting a floor, I can't paint the part I'm standing on. I can paint around it, but I can't paint where I've got my feet. I need a place to stand. So Alexei said, listen, later on, if you keep doing this, you're always going to be missing a piece when you replicate it, so that next time each part of the chromosome will be a little shorter, a little shorter, a little shorter. And then he said something interesting. He said, but chromosomes don't keep shortening because we're all still here. There must be something that comes back later that adds the missing pieces, at least sometimes. That is, when I'm painting the floor, sooner or later I come back later and paint the part I stood on. So, because otherwise, every time I paint the floor, I'll be missing a piece. Every time I replace my chromosome, I'll be missing a piece. So, two things. One is, most cells shorten their chromosomes, which has to do with cell aging, and yet certain cells have to be able to come back later and replace the missing part with something called telomerase, which is what happens in cells that live forever. For example, the germ cell line, which is why our parents, we can trace back biology 3.5 billion years, and the cell line that ended up being you didn't age. Certain cells don't age, and yet many of our cells do age. That's the difference. Some cells shorten telomeres and show changes in gene expression. Some cells go back and replace the missing part, for example, the germ cell line or stem cells.
When the cell divides, they also replace the chromosomes, the missing parts?
Well, again, think of it as two kinds of cells, cells that age and cells that don't. And if I have a cell that ages, every time it replaces the chromosome, it misses a piece at the end, so it keeps getting shorter. And the result is it changes gene expression, and that cell becomes older, call it that. It becomes senescent, it changes its pattern of gene expression. But certain cells, like the germ cell line, so for example, ova, sperm, and a lot of embryonic stem cells, come back later and they replace the missing part. So with each generation of cells, they've replaced the part and they're essentially a brand new, fully functional cell that doesn't age. It's not senescent, it hasn't changed gene expression, it's still healthy. So those are the two extremes. Some cells continue to age and get shorter. Some cells continue to replace themselves with normal length and they maintain themselves indefinitely. They're not immortal, they just don't show any aging.
A cell needs the telomerase for divide, but there is a myth which said that if you add more telomeres, then you can cause cancer in the body. Is telomerase causing cancer?
No. Again, the word cause is part of the problem. Telomerase, for most cancers, they need to have telomerase to continue to divide. But putting in telomerase doesn't cause cancer. And in fact, in most cases, what it does is it lowers the risk of cancer. And the reason is, as my telomeres shorten, one of the things that happens as gene expression changes is I turn down the rate of DNA repair. So if I'm a young cell, in our conversation in the last few minutes, every cell in our body has had some genetic damage, and we repair it as we're talking. Almost flawlessly, we repair it in young cells. But in older cells, the pattern of gene expression changes, and the rate at which DNA repair occurs is turned down. So at any given moment, we're more likely to have a mutation, so we increase our rate of our malignancy of cancer as we get older. So again, in general, telomerase lowers your incidence of cancer because it makes DNA repair much more effective. But there comes a point when the telomere gets short enough and there are a lot of DNA damage. If the cell already has DNA damage and continues to replicate, then one of two things can happen. Either it will, telomeres continue to shorten and the cell will stop dividing, which can prevent the cancer from spreading or continuing to divide, or it can re-express a little telomerase so it doesn't end up repairing its DNA, but it can still divide, in which case you have a clinical cancer. In general, telomerase is likely to be protective. It does something called stabilizing the genome. It makes the DNA more stable, more well-repaired. But in certain cases, as it gets shorter, to continue to divide, a cancer cell needs to have at least a small amount of telomerase in most cases, so it continues to divide and create a cancer. So it's not simple. It's not simply that telomerase is generally a good thing, but in certain cases it can permit, not cause, but can permit cancers to continue to divide if you already have damage.
This was very important to clarify because we have so many myths.
Well, let me say this about the cancer again. It is not true that telomerase causes cancer. Both from theoretical reasons, we know that in general, telomerase would be protective, but in certain cases, it can permit cancer. But we also know this from data. If we look at data, we find that in most cases, telomerase does what we said, which is it's protective against cancer. But again, there are certain cases where you already have damage and it can permit cancer to continue. So it's complex. It's not that telomerase prevents cancer or causes cancer. It depends a bit. In general, it's protective, but there are exceptions.
What happens as the telomeres shorten?
Well, the biggest problem is that pattern of gene expression changes, and the rate at which your cells repair and replace molecules slows down. So let me use an analogy. An analogy might be a cell phone. Most of us have mobile phones. And a very common sort of a contract for many decades has been, or a decade at least, has been a replacement contract, for example, every year or two. So every year or two, I would get my cell phone replaced, and then I'd continue to use my phone, and a year or two, I'd get it replaced. Now, most of us have had some problem with our cell phone. I dropped mine a couple of months ago and broke the screen. My daughter dropped hers in a glass of water. Doesn't work, right? Every now and then, there's spontaneous damage. It just happens. Now, let's look at two extremes. Let's say that right now, you have a contract, and every 2 years, you replace your cell phone. Most of us will get through 2 years, but not all of us. Now let's go to one extreme and say, let's replace a cell phone every 2 days. Very expensive, incredibly expensive, but you'll almost never have a dysfunctional cell phone because you're replacing it so fast that you haven't got time to get any damage to it. That would be expensive, but you'd always have a functional cell phone. At the other extreme, let's say that we replaced our cell phones every 20 years. Almost none of us would have a functional cell phone because cell phones simply don't last that long. It would be cheap, but we'd never have functional cell phones because they wouldn't last 20 years. So that's the spectrum, and this is what's going on with cells. In young cells, you're replacing them very quickly, and it's very expensive, which is why children have high metabolic rates. They go outside and play outside in the winter, and we can't believe they're not freezing, but they're quite comfortable, and you and I are freezing. As we get older, the rate of turnover slows down, and so we are spending less metabolic energy, but we're also accumulating more damage because we're not repairing and replacing it as fast. That's what's going on within cells. There are two kinds of cases of this. In DNA, we repair it. DNA is the only molecule we actually repair. All the other molecules, we simply turn over. So it's like your cell phone. Maybe every 2 years you might replace it, whether it's working or not. That's what's going on in most proteins. So if I look at my skin, for example, and I ask what's going on with the protein molecules between my cells, I could look at both, for example, collagen and elastin, two important molecules, protein molecules in my skin. As I get older, the turnover is dynamic, but it's slowing down the rate. So at any given time, there's much more likely to be damage in those So my skin, as I get older, is less elastic. It's not that I'm not making good elastin molecules, I am, but I'm just not replacing them as fast as I did when I was 6 years old.
Please tell us about misconceptions regarding the telomere theory of aging. There are at least 3 misconceptions.
There are a lot of them. You know, my favorite one is simply the idea that telomeres cause aging. They clearly don't. They play an important role. And from my perception as a clinician, my question isn't what causes aging, because it's an easy way to be intellectually lazy. My question is more difficult, which is, where can we most effectively intervene? Telomeres are probably the single most effective point of intervention, but that's different from saying that telomeres cause aging. That's a misconception. But let me use a more graphic example. I've seen a lot of times in the media, for example, and even in occasional articles, where people will say that telomeres keep your chromosomes from unraveling. Well, chromosomes almost never unravel, because the telomere never gets that short that it unravels. The key change as cells senesce is not that the chromosomes physically come apart. They don't. The key change is the pattern of gene expression that changes. So again, cells are no longer repairing, replacing molecules. The cells are no longer dividing as rapidly. That's the key. The chromosomes don't unravel. A second one that's kind of interesting, because I see this all the time, not just so much in the media as I see in academic literature, is the idea that telomere length is important. Let me say something that's sort of odd, which is telomere length is completely irrelevant. And what I mean by that is that absolute length is irrelevant. It's the relative length that matters. So, for example, some varieties of mice have telomere lengths that are easily 10 times mine, and yet their lifespans are perhaps even 10 times less than mine, less, 35 times less than mine on the average. Why is it then that telomere length that we talk about at all, when some mice have long telomeres and short lifespans, and I have relatively short telomere length and a long lifespan? And it's the difference in, it's the change in telomere length over lifespan. So if my telomeres go from, say, 15 kilobase pairs down to 8 kilobase pairs, that difference is enough to cause enormous changes in my cells. A mouse might have a telomere length that went from 150 kilobase pairs to 100 kilobase pairs. It's still longer than mine, but it's the change that made the difference. So in telomeres and in aging, cell aging, the critical change is not the length of the telomere, it's the change in length. It's not the absolute length, it's the relative length. Or put more precisely, we don't care about the telomere length. What we care about is the change in gene expression. That's everything. So that's the most common misconception that I see all the time. People will say, mice have long telomeres, short lifespans, therefore telomeres don't have anything to do with aging. No, you're misreading the data. It's the change in telomere length, not the length, the change in length. Those are the misconceptions that I think of right away. I'm trying to think of what other ones I'm skipping. Probably something in my book that I've forgotten to mention.
Very interesting. We should meditate more upon these ideas. Very interesting. Now, as we clarified all theories and myths regarding aging, the next logical question is, why do we age?
You ever deal with a young child and they come to you and they say, Christian, why something? And you answer and they say, well, why that? And you answer and they say, why that? And there's never an end to that question. Why? But the problem with why questions is that they are, as I say, sort of intellectually sloppy. That would be like me saying, why do we have this interview this morning? Well, it depends on really what you're asking. We have it because our internet connection worked. We have it because you read my book. We had it because I got involved in research 30, 40 years ago. What are you asking? And the same thing is true of aging. If I say, why do we age? It sort of depends on what you mean by that. I could easily say, well, we age because of free radical damage, cosmic ray damage, other sorts of damage. Not quite true. I could put it a little more accurately, and I could say, it's not that damage causes aging. It's that aging permits damage to occur. But still, it depends on what you mean by why we age. We could ask that question in an evolutionary sense. We could say, why does aging occur at all? Again, that gets a little sloppy. Really, what I'd like to do is be more practical and say, well, let's take two groups that are identical genetically, except that for some reason this group ages very fast, this group ages very slowly, and what happens evolutionarily? And what we find is that in most cases, you'll find that if you live a long time, that's good in a stable environment, stable both physically and biologically. That is, you don't change the temperature or the pH or the oxygen. You don't change your species you're competing with or preying on or that are preying on you. If it's a stable environment, a long lifespan is a useful thing. But if the environment is unstable, for example, if global temperature goes up, if global oxygen goes down, and it's gone up and down over the past few billion years, if the pH changes, if the availability of iron changes, anything that changes in your environment or the biological environment changes, you have more predators coming after you, you have access to fewer prey for you or fewer vegetables you might eat, anything that changes in your environment, you need to adapt rapidly. And you therefore need a slightly shorter lifespan so you can sort of have a faster turning radius. You need to be able to adapt quickly and not keep plowing straight ahead. You need to change. But you also actually need mutations. There's a common misconception that mutations are bad. Well, most of the mutations you and I think of are bad. We think of childhood mutations and a child who's ill. But the truth is, there's a value in mutations. You and I are not the same as the biology we inherited 3.5 billion years ago. There have been a lot of changes, which is why we're here. So mutations have a value for production, for continuation of the species. Again, it helps us make that turn and adapt to an environment. But we don't want too few, we don't want too many. And more importantly, we need to be able to adapt the rate of mutation and the lifespan itself to the degree of change. The faster the change in our environment, the more slightly more mutations we need and the slightly shorter lifespan we need. So it's dynamic. It's not a static phenomenon. If you ask why we age, the answer is it actually helps us adapt to an environment when the environment changes.
And now we are going into more fascinating details. You wrote in your book, and I quote, "When you reverse aging in cells, you reverse aging in tissues." How exactly did the Geron scientists clone the main components of telomerase?
Well, what interests me here is not so much the technical details of how they did it as what happens when they did it. So, for example, we know that back 16 years ago, they showed that if we reset telomeres by putting in telomerase into human cells, you reset the pattern of gene expression. So here I have a cell that was young, and it's slowly gotten older. And the telomere has gotten shorter. And the question is, what happens if we reset telomeres? And when you do that, you find that the cell now acts like a young cell, has a pattern of gene expression that's typical of a young cell, looks like a young cell. So one of the questions that had come up prior to that was, is telomere shortening relevant? Is it just a matter of correlation, or does it actually control cell aging? And we know it controls cell aging, because when we reset it, we reset gene expression, we reset the age of the cell. Now, to go back to the question you asked about cells and tissues, it turns out that cells themselves are critical in terms of tissue function. So it not only is it true within my knee joint, where I have a whole set of chondrocytes that are actually replacing some of the protein molecules and the glucose molecules that are lying between the cells, the matrix tissue that makes my knee nice and slippery and stiff. But it's also true in more complex systems. So for example, if I can show that I can reset the aging in the lining of your coronary arteries, it turns out that'll reset the function of what's going on just under that lining, and that resets also the ability of the coronary arteries to supply blood to your heart. So what I'm saying is the aging of the cells that line your coronary arteries ultimately has an impact on whether you get disease or not. It affects the entire tissue, the entire organ system, not simply the cell itself, but the neighborhood. I remember there's an old saying, you know, no man is an island, every man is part of a continent, John Donne. But this is true. There's no cell that just is living there all by itself. Cells have an impact on cells next to them and sometimes on distant cells as well, very distant cells sometimes.
Because in reality, we are a large community of cells, 80 trillion of cells forming a large community.
Very much so. It's not simply a matter of some individual cell. I sometimes think of aging cells as becoming sociopaths. That is, they're no longer performing their function and they can actually interfere with cells next to them.
Let's suppose that on human trials, you have a group of people, maybe human patients, and you gave me a telomerase activator that the German scientists are working on, and then you check in their status periodically. Is it possible that they look and feel younger if you will take some photos? Would that be possible?
Well, let me start by saying that Geron's no longer working on this. Geron had three types of technology they were working on, and they ended up getting out of this area altogether and focusing just on cancer. But there are a number of other biotech firms and organizations and academic labs that are working on the sort of thing you're talking about. First, let me say this. You certainly, if you took a telomerase activator or you put in a telomerase gene, you wouldn't overnight become young. That wouldn't be true. And it is certainly true that if we look at the telomerase activators that we have right now available on the market, they're not very strong. And we know that people who've been using them orally for 6 to 12 months show some interesting changes, but none of those people have gone from looking 70 to looking 60. It's just that certain changes, for example, in their immune function or in their ability to handle sugar and insulin and so forth, their hypertension, have improved, but none of them have suddenly become dramatically younger. On the other hand, we know that from animal studies, we can take animals that have been showing aging changes and actually not simply slow down those aging changes, but to some extent appear to reverse them in terms of the behavioral function of those animals or the metabolic function of those animals. So we have reason to think that we can not just slow down age-related diseases, but probably reset, cure, reverse some of these diseases, which is why we're going to take these to human trials as soon as we reasonably can.
I did something onto my body, and if you wish to look to these posters, I'll tell you what I did. It was just a hobby experiment.
Yes, I see two pictures. Correct. It looks like you've been somebody went in with Photoshop and adjusted them, or are they really different pictures of you?
Look at the dates.
Ah, yes, I see. And those are accurate. That's a 5-year difference?
Yes.
What would you like me to say about this? One, I can look at this as a physician. And two, I obviously, you know, want to be careful what I say about anything. What would you like me to comment on? It certainly is true that the 2015 one, on the face of it, looks a little older than the 2010 image.
But I also have some close-up details.
Ah, yes.
Can you make it full screen?
I have made it full screen for me. I don't want to adjust your camera angle to get rid of the sun for me, so I'm using my hand to shield it. They're a little hard to say from the quality of the two images. On the one hand, the contrast between them is a little different, and one picture is a little more detail than the other one.
Yes, but on the other one, which has less contrast, I have deeper wrinkles.
Yes, and you think they've improved in the 2-year period?
Yes.
And what were you using in the meantime? Because you're right, the skin looks a little different, but the wrinkles look like they may be a little less deep.
Yes.
I wouldn't want to bet on it, but that's the initial impression. What was the difference? Were you using a telomerase activator?
No. I did a biological transformation which added replacing parts for the cells.
What was it you were using?
Some sort of meditation and yoga.
Oh, good for you.
I was having lumbar discopathy for over 15 years, and now it is completely cured. And I have the MRIs to confirm it, and now I'll do a third MRI in January, and I believe I'll see that I'm completely cured.
Well done. You know, one of the things, we talked about this before, about common conceptions. It has to do with entropic theory of aging. And one of the misconceptions is that aging cannot be changed. Well, we know a number of things can change aging or can change the rate of aging. The question is, how effectively can we intervene? And one example of this sort of fatalism is the World Health Organization had a report that came out last month. And Margaret Chan in there said that it was time to give up the curative model of aging diseases. Basically, she was saying, you can't do anything about it. We shouldn't even try. And I think that's a mistake, whether it's your experience in dealing with things or other people or the sort of approach we're trying to take. I think there's reason to think that we can affect the underlying cellular aging process that causes disease. It's not simply a matter of it just happens, give up. That's a mistake. I grant you that a lot of the therapies that we currently use, typical drugs on the market, don't affect aging. They don't really do anything for Alzheimer's disease. They do very little for cardiovascular disease or for lumbar discopathy. And yet, that doesn't mean we can't intervene. I think we can. We just need to be a little more thoughtful about how we do it.
And my explanations, if you are interested to read about them, I had published on a paper in an Indian journal.
Yes, that's it. Good. I'm downloading the PDF now. Christian, I love modern technology. It's so nice. You and I could never have done this 10 years ago or 20 years ago.
This is very good to spread more information and quick and exchange experiences and ideas.
And maybe open people's minds a bit.
Yes, indeed.
I had a very similar problem for years, and I ended up falling out of a tree and shattered one vertebra in countless pieces. I broke the other one in half. And oddly enough, I've had no pain at all for the past 15 years since then. Absolutely fine. It's as though I instantly cured all my back problems. I don't recommend that to my patients, but it was sort of amusing the way I did it. Back to your point, though, about the ability of the mind to do things. I long ago got intrigued by biofeedback. And they used to bring me down to New York University because I could control my heart rate and my blood pressure independently. Well, a lot of people don't think you can do that, and you can. You can learn to control a number of things in your body. But one of the questions that always comes to my mind is, to what extent will that have an impact on disease, for example, age-related diseases? The body has an enormous capacity to repair, and that rate of repair goes down with age, but it doesn't go to zero either. So let's say, for example, that I'm very stressed. And in some sense, I'm increasing my rate of aging in certain degrees. If I lower my rate of stress, I may make it easier for my repair capacity to deal with that. So I still may be aging, but now my aging rate is slowed down, and I'm repairing a lot of the problems that I couldn't keep up with before because I had a high stress. So I, when I think of things like meditation, for example, or exercise, or a good diet. These are all reasonable things to do, not because they stop aging, but they do lower the sort of damage rate you've got and allow your body to deal with it as best you can. I think we can also go at a more fundamental level and reset your ability to repair and deal with stress, but that's still no reason to not deal with stress. We should, whether, again, meditation, exercise, whatever you're thinking, those things are critical to cut down the rate of damage that we're all incurring day to day. It would be like me saying, maybe I can increase the rate of DNA repair. That's still no reason I want to be exposed to radiation. The lower the exposure to radiation, the less damage I incur. Now, it's true that as I get older, I'm less and less able to repair the damage, but that's still no reason to undergo a lot of radiation exposure. And the same thing is true of stress. Whether I'm dealing with it, meditation or something else, that has an impact. It doesn't prevent aging, but it does slow down the rate of aging and slow down your rate of damage.
The lumbar discopathies are degenerative diseases because the mitochondria in the cells of the disc are no longer powering the cell with the ATP, and I replace the mitochondria with new mitochondria from donor cells. And we have cells in our body which are not linked to any tissue, and they are free cells, but are only two types, stem cells and reproductive cells. And I brought the mitochondria from the reproductive cells. That is how I described in my paper, if you'll have some time later on to read it.
I would love to. When you mention the mitochondria, there's another good example. We find that when we reset telomere length, you reset mitochondrial function. So I can have an old dysfunctional cell, reset telomeres, and what happens is, for reasons I could get into in detail, the mitochondria begin to function like young, normal mitochondria. So it's another way in which we could approach this problem, I think.
Yeah.
Either way, what always disappoints me is when a physician will tell you something can't be cured. What a physician really means is, I don't know how to cure it. That would be the honest way to put it. And that's fair. But to say something can't be cured really is an admission not only of ignorance, but in some sense of hubris. You're saying it can't be done, and I know it can't be done. No. That's like going back 100 years or 150 years and saying, you know, human beings will never learn to fly. Well, we did. We've got airplanes that work fine, thank you. So throughout history, we've had a tendency to say something can't be done, where we should say, I don't know how to do it. Most diseases, the ones you're dealing with and the ones I'm dealing with, age-related diseases, probably can be cured. The question is, how do we do it?
I am reading your book with great interest. Page 73, and I quote, "When we think of aging, we stop thinking." Please explain why most of us do have this belief, because we believe we age and when we age, but very few people try to prevent this until you came and a group of very few well-motivated scientists.
We assume that there's nothing you can do about aging, and that's a reasonable belief. And there are a number of reasons for this. One is most of the animals that we interact with age. The ones that don't age, for example, certain hydra may not age, are not things that we see day to day in our lives. We don't watch a hydra every day. We do watch our dog or our cat or our family members age. Another reason, though, if you look back historically, you know, the oldest known piece of human literature is the Epic of Gilgamesh. And in the very last chapter, they talk about a plant that grows underwater that can restore lost youth. Well, it's fiction. And for the past 4,700 years, everything that's talked about the possibility of reversing aging has been fiction. And often not just fiction, but often a scam. Somebody's trying to make money off of you. So if we talk about the possibility of reversing aging or changing the aging process, people not unreasonably start by assuming that it has to be nonsense. They don't know any animals that don't age. Everything that's talked about aging is probably a scam. So how can this possibly be true? But in consequence, we stop thinking about aging at all. So when we talk about aging, we stop thinking. We just assume nothing can be done without asking ourselves, what's really going on? And that's something that's begun to change in the past 50 years, and especially in the last 20 years. We've begun to realize that aging is not simply a matter of things fall apart, it just happens, it's always happens. No, it's more complex, it doesn't always happen, some things can change it. Example. We know that dietary restriction can slow the aging process. We know that we can breed animals to have longer or shorter lifespans. We also know that when we alter genes or the pattern of gene expression, we can often alter the aging process. So clearly aging can be changed. The key practical question is not, can aging be changed? Because it can. The practical question is, can we alter it in such a way as to prevent disease, tragedy, suffering, pain? For example, Alzheimer's disease, heart disease. And there the answer is, we probably can.
Dear Professor Michael Fossil, I thank you very much for part one of our interview, and please let's continue with part two in our next program.
If you're going to do that, I'll refill my coffee cup and I'll be back in just a moment.
Okay, and goodbye.
Fiecare îmbătrânim cu viteze diferite, iar aceasta se datorează mai multor factori, printre care și modul în care ne gestionăm energiile biologice, stilul de viață, dieta și la care mai intervine acel ceas biologic care la un moment dat ne anunță că e vremea să părăsim corpul fizic. Niciodată nu vom găsi două persoane care să îmbătrânească cu aceeași viteză. Fotografiile personale prezentate în acest episod nu arată nimic altceva decât diferențe pur subiective ale profunzimii unor procese fiziologice ce diferă de la un om la altul chiar foarte mult. Un articol publicat pe internet ne prezintă fotografii senzaționale ale unui yoghin din Turcia în vârstă de 95 de ani care sugerează că a descoperit leacul tinereții fără bătrânețe. Dar avem și exemple din România, precum cel al academicianului Ovidiu Bojor în vârstă de 90 de ani, care e convins că, citez, a munci cu drag este marele secret al creșterii speranței de viață. La pagina 171 din cartea lui Michael Fossil, numită Revoluția telomerazei, există un alt citat din Molière care spune următoarele: mai mulți oameni mor din cauza remediilor decât a bolilor. Data viitoare vom continua discuțiile pe subiecte importante legate de îmbătrânire și anume epigenetica, posibilitatea vindecării tuturor maladiilor legate de îmbătrânire precum Alzheimer, ateroscleroză, Parkinson și alte maladii degenerative. Vom analiza mituri legate de cancer și spre final veți afla care e durata de viață pe care specialiștii o preconizează pe baza terapiei telomerice și peste cât timp va fi disponibilă pentru noi toți. Fiți alături de noi data viitoare la o nouă întâlnire cu știință și cunoaștere!